Okay, if you'd like to gradually make your way to a seat. I have a few announcements. The first one is that there is no known contagion at the front of the auditorium. So your health is not at risk if you sit further forward. Few housekeeping announcements. First, if at the end of the conference, just in case anybody's leaving first thing in the morning or tonight, if you could return your name badge holders to the registration desk on your way out, we can reuse those for other events and save some plastic. The evaluation forms, likewise, at the end of the when you leave, can be left at the registration desk. The one tech breakdown that I'm aware of today was in Ashley Mamash's session titled Reframing Veiled Images, where there was a video that failed that was part of the presentation. So we've arranged to have that video shown at the end of this evening's session. So if you were in that sectional and you'd like to see that video, hang around here at the end of the plenary and we'll be showing it in here. And everyone else, there'll be a reception out in the lobby again, like there was yesterday evening. Just before I transition, I'd just like to say thank you for today. We started this conference 10 years ago in 2005. And a big part of the goal behind this conference was to try to address an area in which there seemed to be very little joined up public discourse, which is how faith relates to teaching and learning, and try to just generate a community of conversation and some exchange and some good work. And it's been very encouraging to me again to see, first just the interdisciplinary nature of the conversation. We've heard papers today from a bunch of different disciplinary perspectives and different backgrounds and discourses and expertises. It's been a very civil discourse from what I've heard in the rooms that I've been in. But it's also just nice to see some themes being pursued, some arguments being refined, some things recurring from previous years and getting pursued a bit further, and so on, and just seeing some good work emerging out of this. So I'm very grateful to all of you that have presented today. This was what we started dreaming of a decade ago and have been trying to gradually help bring a little more of into being. I'm also thankful this evening to be able to introduce Candace Vogler to you. I would love to be able to claim that the reason I was able to invite Candace was because I assiduously keep up with all the latest writings in moral philosophy, but I actually discovered Candace in a canyon in Texas, quite literally, where we were both involved in some faculty development with Baylor University faculty at a place called Laity Lodge. And we've done that the last couple of years. And so I've had a couple of opportunities to listen to Candace present to a group of faculty around questions involving teaching and faith. And Candace to me is a wonderful combination of, clearly a very able and careful philosopher, so working in the realms of great precision, and yet in person possessed of a kind of expansive zest and human warmth in exploring the contours of how the big questions that she works with affect what we do with each other in human situations. Candace is the David B. and Clara E. Stern Professor of Philosophy and Professor in the College at the University of Chicago. There's a list in here, I was just going through the list in the printed bio here of her publication topics: ethics, social and political philosophy, philosophy and literature, cinema, psychoanalysis, gender studies, sexuality studies, and other areas. I think this evening I trust that Candace is going to speak about the other areas. So welcome, Candace, thank you for being with us.
Thank you very much, David, for that wonderful introduction. And I just want to say thank you to all of you for today. I have learned so much going to hear your papers and be part of sessions. I wish I could have gone to all of them. The 12 I heard were great. Okay, let's see. Oh, I so want to do this that I'm just going to do this. Peace be with you. I can't do that in my classrooms. I teach at a university that started life as a Baptist seminary, but has since become very proudly unaffiliated with any particular religious tradition. So it's an interesting place to be a Christian educator, actually, because you don't get to actually say what you're doing a lot of the time, unless somebody comes to see you in office hours and has sort of scoped out that probably you're friendly. We'll talk to you about these things. Okay. This environment that we're sharing at this conference is both beautiful and actually pretty safe. Most of the classrooms where I work feel much more perilous than this, to me and to my students. It doesn't take a whole lot of courage to do the kind of thing we've been doing for a couple of days, meeting and greeting each other, and exchanging conversation ideas about where we work and all that sort of stuff, although it does take a little bit. I am going to talk about things this evening that require a little more bravery than we've had to use so far. I'm going to start with just talking a little bit about the nature of Christian virtue generally, but drawing from work by Thomas Aquinas as my Christian virtue theorist. He's my favorite neo-Aristotelian. So I'm going to get medieval on you just a little bit. But I'm going to do that partly because he provides a sort of general way for thinking about what makes a quality or a character trait or an aspect of a person count as a virtue. There's all kinds of things that we can recognize and deeply appreciate in one another that you wouldn't think of as qualifying as virtues. So part of what I found really useful about Aquinas is a kind of systematic way of trying to narrow the field a little and think about what it is you're saying about some quality when you're dignifying it with a name like virtue, which is sort of a particular kind of strength, moral strength. And I'm going to move toward talking about cultivating virtue specifically in a classroom. Now, a lot of us have been talking all day about different ways of using assignments that send students outside of the classroom to help them cultivate virtue. And that's the easiest way to understand how to relate Christian practice to virtue formation in our students, I think, is by way of thinking about how much we give them to read, how we tell them to read it, where we tell them they should go, what we tell them they should do outside of class, all that sort of thing. I'm going to try to actually focus in on classrooms, spaces where I teach that are kind of like this, only you would be going up like that in fixed chairs, and I'd be down here. And you'd all think I can't see you. And I'd let you know I can by commenting on things like, you look really, was dinner okay? Did something bad happen? How are we doing? So I'm going to talk a little bit about what I do in lecture classes to try to produce a community of inquiry that can actually provide the support necessary to cultivate some aspects of courage in that classroom. And I'm going to tell a slightly different story about what I do in discussion classes, which I don't get to teach nearly as often because I'm doing a lot of service teaching, because I am the person in ethics at the University of Chicago in the philosophy department for the last 22 years. So I'm supervising 10 dissertations. It's like 4 BA projects, 2 MA theses this year. That's kind of what, and I do a lot of service teaching. So it's, I don't get to do a whole lot of little discussion sessions. I've given you a handout, which even though it's only one page long, has a typo. Number 5, that should be end paren, not 0. Not specifically Z, nothing. But it's basically, it contains the kind of thing that I would normally write on a blackboard before the start of a class. I get there before my students get there, which is sometimes, given the scheduling of lecture halls at the University of Chicago, is sometimes a little tricky, because if the person before us goes over, I have to like race to the head of the line to get in, head straight for the blackboard and write some sort of an outline of what I'm going to be talking about. And I do that partly because that has me moving around physically in the front of the room as people are coming in. And it makes it possible for me to get these things up, say things like, can you read that from back there? Do I need this, should this be bigger or smaller? It's all about trying to humanize a space that doesn't feel particularly humane. It's a kind of an alienating space to walk into. So I do all that. So there I am dancing around with chalk, writing big in the front of the room. And then we greet each other before we do anything else. We say hello to everybody says hello to the person next to them. We greet each other as a way of marking the start of the time that we have in the classroom together for the lecture period and setting it apart from whatever we were doing beforehand. And making it about the group of people in the room somehow, even in a lecture setting where that's not always easy to do or maintain. So we do that. The handout also has all the quotations I'll read on it. Okay. Now. Thomas Aquinas is the 13th century Dominican, of course, who wrote many, many, many books, almost all of which were designed to be read by developing clergy to help them learn. I mean, the ST is supposed to be like the basic text. it's very difficult, very cryptic, and so on. I have not read everything that Aquinas wrote. I'm still working through a lot of the gospel commentaries and things, but he's pretty extraordinary. He is, of course, deeply influenced by Aristotle's work, but unlike the ancient pagan philosophers, Aquinas's neo-Aristotelian account of virtue begins from the fall from grace and what original sin did to us. So it begins at the point where, as Susan told us last night, that very famous couple swallowed the wrong story. That's where you start. Okay, and what happens, it gets sort of neatly described in the phrase darkened intellect, disturbed passions, and disordered will. That's a description of how things are for human beings generally in our experience. The phrase points to all of the ways that perfectly ordinary people and people of excellent character and people sunk in darkness fall short of the kind of good that human beings can do, enable, support, and encourage in this life. So it's about our powers not working together the right sort of way. We fail. And stunningly, most people, in some sense at least, most people know better when they do something they're not supposed to do. You can sort of tell because of the defensive inner monologue that starts right away about why this was an appropriate thing to do or why this is an unusual circumstance that calls for whatever thing that's kind of shabby that just happened might be, right? Assuming, as seems to me plausible, that none of us has a whole lot of experience with an entirely well-ordered and well-governed human being, we should be at least as impressed by the fact that people know better as we are by the fact that people fail. What it looks like not to fail, I think, is not in our experience of one another very prominently. Unless you guys live in a very different world than I do. Right, my people I know are kind of messy. Okay, myself included. For Aquinas, cultivation of virtue helps to remedy disorder in our lives. And even though very few of us are going to develop harmonious, reasonable, practical orientations directed at good with or without discipline and training, Aquinas, like Aristotle, takes it that we are drawn that way. Fundamentally, he thinks, we seek to pursue good and avoid bad. The term is malum. It's a very general term for bad. Evil is not a good translation of it. Evil brings in another element that shouldn't be there. Pursue good and avoid bad, which is why I think we have it in us to work to improve ourselves in the first place. And he's taking this partly from Augustine, who said that this was something that could not be blotted out from the heart of man, this directive to pursue good and avoid bad. It's just writ in. And it's not just writ into man in Aquinas, it's writ into creation in Aquinas. So like it's in my cats too. It's just that they don't impede themselves. They don't get in their way. They know that that's a thing worth going for, that shiny thing over there, and so off they go. And they're right, right? With me, I can know that's a thing worth going for, and it'll be like, well, maybe tomorrow I would, it's a good idea, I could start in that direction or something like that. We impede ourselves. All kinds of things about us get in our way. And that's not true of non-human creatures on Aquinas' reading of the natural world. That's part of what makes us special, okay? For Aquinas, human nature as we know and experience it is fallen nature. We are, he thinks, operating at a loss. The deficit comes from a loss of what he called original justice. Okay. How did things stand for us before the fall, according to Aquinas? What was it like when everything was the way it was meant to be? You've got first quote on the handout. Eileen Sweeney puts it this way, quote, what is strange about Aquinas' view is that a purely natural state of humankind has, strictly speaking, never existed. Before the fall, nature had a kind of supernatural strength. God was giving Adam a bunch of crutches in all kinds of ways and helping him, right? And after that, nature is somewhat, though not radically, depleted, close quote. The supernatural strength in original justice was a matter of orientation and governance. The human's higher powers were subject to God. The lower powers were subject to the higher powers. The body was subject to the mind. In the commentary on Romans, Aquinas adds another one that I love. Nothing in the creation could harm a human being. So like Adam couldn't even stub his toe. It was built that way. It's kind of nice. Okay. So in the prelapsarian condition, humans could enjoy perfect rectitude of the will. In the prelapsarian condition, we could act on our innate love of God without getting in our own ways. This is the sense in which the gift of original justice perfects human nature. It places our powers in proper order, given the kinds of creatures we are. They're all arranged the way that they're supposed to be. Original sin deprives us of original justice. Original justice is an ordering of mentality and will that allows us to direct ourselves to good appropriately. The darkening of the intellect consists in our finding ourselves in a situation where the intellect is no longer directed to God, the lower powers are no longer subject to reason, and the body is no longer subject to the mind. Just as the first is the most important in original justice, its loss is the most important loss occurred through original sin. So the subjection of the intellect to God, that's the most important one. Rational appetite no longer effectively operates in and from practical wisdom, excellence in judgment and volition appropriately governed by love of God. Because of this, the passions are disturbed. Although it's most common in talking about this in Aquinas to emphasize the ramifications of the loss of original justice in terms of the loss of the downward subjections, intellect to God, right? Lower powers to higher powers, body to soul, one could just as easily emphasize the upward inclination toward good that's impeded by that loss. Like all these things want to be directed the way they're supposed to be. All of our bits actually want to be well ordered. It gives us something to go on. Okay, that's the view. Okay. Impediment, of course, isn't the same as obliteration. The corrective supplied by virtues like temperance, courage, justice, and prudence, practical wisdom, is meant to address the loss of the kind of governance proper to our natures, given the kinds of creatures that we are, to begin to reintegrate our powers, or at least foster cooperation among them in a way that helps to rectify the will. In effect, for our kind of intellect, the sort that an animal can embody, and for our kind of animal, the sort endowed with intellect as such, oriented to the highest good possible for us, the darkening of the intellect is the loss of the order in inclination and governance that helps us to direct ourselves to the goods it belongs to us to pursue. Okay? Now, many of us have, even today, sometimes following Alistair McIntyre's lead, and he's a slippery guy, okay? He's a funny guy. He was this like rough and tumble Marxist working class guy in his youth, you may know, and got into big kinds of fights and still loves to shake things up. It's what he likes to do. But basically, he, drawing on Anscombe's work, this is the source for this idea, as he will actually tell you publicly, held that all of our understanding of virtue and morality had been in modern times in disarray, has now come into disarray. That we lack the kind of context necessary to make shared sense of our moral lives, that living in the kind of pluralistic democratic polity where we find ourselves, we're not going to have any way of finding a shared moral code, that whether or not there's intractable moral disputes, even that's up for grabs. We can't even say for sure whether that's the case, and so on. So he emphasizes all that kind of thing, this extreme social disorder, and how that affects the horizon of possibilities for individual human beings who are trying to like meet the challenge of being good people, leading good lives. I think that even Alistair would not say that the basic directive to pursue good and avoid bad was somehow out of this picture. What it is rival understandings of what it means for the human being, one of our kind, to pursue good and avoid bad. And the way you explain those differences sometimes has to do with history and culture, sometimes has to do with tendencies that crop up in various places for various people at various times. But varying catalogs of virtue and so on, the fact that there are a lot of them, should not make you feel demoralized or discouraged about the language of virtue. Especially if, like McIntyre knows perfectly well, you have somebody like Aquinas around who tells you what makes one of these qualities count as a virtue, namely that it tends to the perfection and order and governance of our powers. So you're looking for, where's the disorder that's addressed by this thing that we're calling a virtue? What's the thing in us that's out of whack that would somehow be rectified a little, or brought into alignment a little, or put in its proper place a little by the thing that's being proposed as a virtue? That would be the way you would handle this if you wanted to sort of side with Aquinas, on my reading at least, even in the face of somebody as compelling as McIntyre telling you that it's going to be very hard to find the basis for moral conversation. It's not actually that hard to find the basis for moral conversation if you stick to the thought that making sense of what people do and feel and think and how they respond to one another is kind of rooted in the understanding that these are human beings who are pursuing good and avoiding bad. The most perplexing behavior you can imagine, right? I pursued this anecdotally by talking to a psychiatric admitting nurse in a state hospital, basically. So we see these very disturbed human beings pretty routinely. The most peculiar, if you can't understand the sense in which, for this person, that strange behavior seems better than an alternative, right? Diving under the table, not bathing for 2 months, screaming whenever anybody comes near is better than eye contact if you don't see how raw that person is to casual human contact and don't see this as a way of trying to avoid something unbearable. You can't touch this person in a healing way. You can shoot them full of drugs and make them stop doing the thing that's bothering you by immobilizing them somehow, but you can't touch them in a healing way unless you can see the sense in which what they're doing is going for something good, avoiding something that feels at that point bad or worse. A colleague of mine, Jonathan Lear, and I have traced Augustine's sentence all the way down through, in psychoanalysis, Freud, Lacan, and Melanie Klein. It works all the way down through those three psychoanalytic theorists. So that's kind of profound. Like, avoid bad, pursue good, turns out to be a fundamental grid for intelligibility, even for these kind of like wild-eyed psychoanalytic people, or calmer ones like my colleague Jonathan, who is very put together. Okay? I mention this because that's a thing you have going for you if you buy this view every time you walk into a classroom. A thing you share with everybody else in that room is a desire to pursue good and avoid bad, okay? It may very well be, I'm one of the people who thinks that it is the case, that avoiding bad can be a pretty complicated matter, but that there are some kinds of acts that, as Aristotle put it, are whose name implies badness, where there is no mean with respect of these, there is no way to, anytime you do one of these things, you're always wrong and never right, and so on. That is, I think that there are such things as absolute prohibitions. I have not seen any indication that there's an absolute positive practical requirement geared to a type of act. There's positive requirements about loving God, but that can involve many different kinds of activity. There's positive requirements about things like honoring your mother and father, but that can involve many different kinds of act, right? It's in the realm of prohibition that you get badness attached to a kind of action, okay? So I think that one of the ways that people become very worried about moral discussion is that they become so impressed by the thought that there aren't these positive requirements that they extend that idea to cover the whole field. That there are no positive requirements basically means most of the time there's more than one sort of thing you could do that would be a good kind of thing to do. Necessity doesn't actually enter in. That there are prohibitions means that there are some kinds of things that it's never okay to do. And if Aristotle's right, you can tell by the names of the acts and the kind of attention people pay to them. Genocide, never okay, not even for a little people. Right? It's a name that was invented to describe a kind of collective action that it's never okay to do. Okay? And as such, there's been tremendous work done trying to figure out what counts as genocidal. Rape, kind of thing it's never okay to do, As such, an enormous amount of human attention paid to which kinds of things count as acts of rape. I think when I was born, it was not legally possible in the United States for a husband to rape his wife. Conjugal rights were such that this was not a possible thing that could occur. Now it is possible. People have thought, yeah, no, that's a kind of thing that can occur even in that relationship. Whatever's going on with conjugal rights isn't the sort of thing that removes the possibility of that kind of wrongfulness between two people. Okay? I mention all of this because we're talking about, in talking about virtue, we're talking about acquired traits that are going to help individuals and communities in the pursuit of common good and the avoidance of bad. Do it individually and help them do it collectively. And in the individual, it does it by rebalancing human powers, emotions, reason, feelings, fears, will, all that stuff, by bringing them into alignment with each other. That's the basic picture of what makes something count as a virtue. Deeply indebted to an understanding of fallen human nature, hence ought to be sort of friendly to most of us. Like, you don't have to accept transubstantiation or a celibate clergy or to think that this is a useful framework for organizing thought about virtue. So far, so good. Doing okay. Digesting food, some smiles. I know, we're low on jokes. It'll get funny in a second. I'm not above trying to amuse, which was a topic in our work on anxiety in a session late this afternoon. I'm not above that. Okay. So what do I do in a lecture class in moral philosophy? This has been like some theology, some moral philosophy. We've been flying pretty high here. So now I'm in a room with my students, and there's various things I do. The first thing I have to do with my students is show them that they actually have some moral knowledge, not just opinions, right? Not just feelings, but knowledge. Because if they don't have any moral knowledge, there's nothing for my moral of philosophy class to be the philosophy of. We don't have our topic. So I am committed at this point in my teaching career to spending as long as it takes to help my students find the core of moral knowledge that they bring into that classroom. And I do it by being really stupid in front of them and letting them tell me what I've done wrong and correct me over and over again. This is not, the example that's been working best the past couple of years goes sort of like this. I say to them, okay, suppose this is the situation. I've been in this long-term relationship, romantic relationship. Now, I realize that for you guys, long-term could be like 3 months or 2 days or something. When you get to be my age, you're talking decades, right? That's what a long-term relationship looks like. But I've been in one of these, and you know, it's not going to go anywhere for me anymore. I'm done with this. I'm through. This is it. So I need to, of course, communicate this to the person who's soon to be my former beloved, right? So we've both got smartphones, and I send a text. And the students are like, what? I have a text, because it's like... And the students are sort of like, you can't do that in a text. Oh, okay. Why? Well, I can't... It's not... You're just not allowed to do that in a text. It is rude to do that. They use the language of courtesy to mask moral knowledge all the time. They talk about imposition. They talk about things being rude. They talk about not wanting to do things that sound kind of like, you know, showing up uninvited for supper. You know, only they use that to mean moral norms. So it's rude. So they say, okay. So then I phone the person and leave a voicemail. Like maybe it's that it was, you know, text and instead of the sound of my voice saying, this is it, we're done, you know. And they're like, no, you can't do that either. It's still rude. We wouldn't even do it with somebody we'd been dating a month, you know, or a week or 4 days. You just don't do that. Okay. So suppose instead it goes like this. I invite him out with me for some fancy public dinner at a nice place where we ate sometimes. I buy this big meal, we sit down, it's really nice, and I stage this huge fight, this epic, screaming, totally embarrassing, knocking things over kind of fight to try to break it off, right? And my students are like, that's better. And I'm like, really? Because usually you would think that it's like more rude to go into a big restaurant and like stage a huge fight than it is to, you know, do something on the privacy of my smartphone to yours or voicemail. No, it's better. Why? Why is that better? Because you give the person a chance to answer back. Well, why does that matter? Because you've had this relationship. You've had intimacy with one another. You've built something together. These are my, you know, apathetically relativistic students, right? They're producing moral knowledge and expanding on it and articulating it. Okay. So why is that? Why are those important? Little discussion about the role of intimacy and love in leading a full human life. They're educating me still. I'm taking this in for them. I'm asking them questions. I'm running up and down the aisle. I'm talking to them. As you've probably noticed, I don't stand still very well. Is that a thing I know how to do very well? Gradually, we get to a point where we start talking about moral codes and why those matter. And these kids who are like, I know they're in their 20s and they're emerging adults and stuff, but you know, gray hair, they're kids to me still. They're my kids. These kids will begin working together even in a lecture hall, where they're in these weird rows, to sort of working together produce an understanding of what a moral code does for a community, how it helps you make sense of yourself, how it helps you understand the point of what the community is doing. Right? And gradually, they develop a partial, but I think pretty deep and serious articulation of the kind of good a moral code is. At that point, it's pretty easy to see why you wouldn't want to mess with one of those casually. Because you'd be messing with a system that provides the context in which, for a whole community, individuals and the community as a whole are understanding their pursuit of good. Right. So we get there from texting. And from there, we've got the start of really quite a lot, okay? And then we can start talking about disorder, and then we can start talking about virtues, and we can start talking about other things. But I'm relying the whole time on these things I think I've learned from Aquinas about all of them having this thing that Augustine taught us about in them, about all of them having the light of natural reason in them, about all of them being fellow creatures, right, who have it in them to try to strive for the highest good they can imagine, whatever that happens to be. My imagination is getting caught up in inventing scenarios where they can help me understand what's going on. And I can, in the process of eliciting that stuff, get a deeper understanding of how they're going to respond to the material that we're going to be working with together all term. Like, what are the real strengths here? How are we collectively developing a shared vision of the field of moral philosophy? And what, how you would begin to understand or engage in serious moral argument if there was a disagreement? You better figure out what good is at stake here for each group. You better figure out why the way that people is doing something is striking these people over here as inimical to some basic human good, right? So that we, through this kind of indirect understanding of a human person, indirect understanding of human nature, indirect understanding of the character of humans as social beings in life with one another, we are together in this normally dehumanizing lecture hall providing the fabric we need to do some moral philosophy. And I don't care how imaginative I have to be, I don't care how morally stupid I have to be, I don't care any of that. I don't care that it takes the first 2 weeks of class in a quarter. If we can't find that basis for shared conversation in the room, we don't have any way of approaching things like heavy-duty readings, which get assigned in tiny bits and gone through line by line. And they're absolutely alive to prohibition stuff. So not only do they get the indeterminate pursue good, avoid bad stuff, they are very sensitive to the wrongness of genocide, the wrongness of rape, the wrongness of murder. For my students, actually, the wrongness of torture. I'm with them, I confess, in that. That these are acts whose name implies badness. There is no mean with respect of these, to use the Aristotle language. Never right, always wrong, and it may not even be, and there's obviously going to be reason to devote a lot of attention to figuring out what kinds of things count as instances of this sort of act, and room for disagreement about it, because it's so important to know. Because it can never be right to do. And we're making sense of one another by developing stories and imagination for the way in which each of us can be seen as pursuing good and avoiding bad. And if these things are always bad, you better know if this counts as one of those because you don't want to do it. Okay? That's how we start in a lecture classroom for moral philosophy. To kind of cope with this. Now, in the course of this, we build a particular sort of a relationship with each other, even in a lecture hall. Okay. Sometimes, when I taught at UCLA for a while, and my intro ethics course at UCLA had 320 students in it. Okay. And you can't, with 320 people, you can't even see your whole class standing in one place. Like, you have to run back and forth from one side of the front of the room to another to even lay eyes on the people who are your students. But this was the first place that I started trying this out. There was actually discussion in a class of 320, and it was occasionally alarming. Because I was staying in a place sort of down at the heels place that had been a sorority before it lost its standing as a sorority, and now was just a women's rooming house that was about two blocks from campus, Our den mother was called Irene Cope. I thought I Cope is a really nice name for the den mother of a down-at-heel sorority. But it turns out that some of the other young women in my rooming situation had boyfriends who were in my class, so it was not unusual for there to be a knock at my bedroom door at 2 o'clock in the morning as one of these students had a question. So I had to like figure out how to set some limits with them, because I love them, but not with my nightie, you know, not at 2 in the morning. It's not that much, right? Okay. But that's a way of going about trying to sort of set a stage in one of those kinds of classes. Does it make sense? I mean, it also goes to cutting some of the mastery business, because I'm always the person who doesn't know what to do. And I always get to be sort of surprised by the ways they have of trying to tell me why I shouldn't do what I'm telling them I'm about to do. They always are letting me into the world that they're actually inhabiting as they're trying to educate the idiot at the front of the room. I do not mind being the idiot at the front of the room. It suits me, okay, in these settings, because it gives them a place to actually work out what they would say to somebody who was stupid enough to try to do one of these things, okay? I have various other strategies for doing this. Sometimes I've taught lecture courses with a syllabus that's so demanding that I have never met the human being who could teach this syllabus from the position of mastery, ever, right? The two people I know who would be most likely couldn't do it. They're the ones that have all the languages and all the thises and all the thats, right? Necessary. And I tell the students that this is a syllabus that can't, I don't know anybody who's got scholarly mastery of the materials on this syllabus. I've never met that person. I'm not that person. I'm somebody who's found this stuff really useful in trying to think about myself and the world that we are all sharing here. And I'm working out at it too, and I'm going to give you my best shot. And it's true, I've been working at it about 20 years more than you have, so my best shot is probably a little more informed or something than your best shot, but I really am not in charge of this syllabus. That's what you get if you're teaching a syllabus that starts with Descartes, then you do some Hegel, then you're in Marx, then you're, you know, you're doing Gramsci, and you're doing this, and then you're doing that, all the way through to contemporary work from high-end journals. Not me. They understand that. They understand that what they're seeing is somebody trying to wrestle with this material. And I don't feign wrestling with the material. I actually do wrestle with the material. So I will come in and say, okay, here's what I think makes sense of this piece of Hegel. This is what I think today is going on here. Now, I've been working on this piece of Hegel for a while, but it's a piece of Hegel, okay? It's hard. And they respond very well to all of that. So in these two kinds of scenarios, I'm trying to undo a thing about mastery and create an environment in a lecture hall that is really human. Okay. The other kind of thing I do with lecture classes may not work at your place. It works at the University of Chicago because most of my students are students who were like the best kid in high school, in their high school class. They were like really, really good. They've got incredible pride attached to their intellectual activity. They came to the University of Chicago because it was hard. It was intense. It's where people think. Like, that's not what's going on at the bus stop. I mean, it's crazy. But like, what world are you living in, kids? But that's who they are. And so what they like to do with assignments, even assignments that are creatively designed to make them engage the world in an unusual way, is go find some way to run off and perform a solitary act of brilliance. And then present me with the shiny result, okay? And you know, they're really good at performing solitary acts of brilliance. It's how they got where they are. It's how they're expecting to get the next five places they want to be, and so on. They are not at all accustomed to thinking of each other as a primary educational resource. That's no part of their imaginary for the classroom. So, for several years now, I've done various things to try to get them to see one another as a tremendous educational resource. Really strong stuff. One of the things I give take-home exams occasionally. The take-home exams are incredibly challenging. I always write two versions of any take-home exam. There's the one for works of solitary brilliance. It has to be done by one person. That person can go off and be as shiny as she pleases. The other can only be done by two or more people. There has to be a group. And there will be some clever little quote about wherever two or more are gathered together, you know, such and such. They often name their groups. I tell them that I'm so committed to getting them used to working collaboratively. These students who have a horror of group work because they remember it as the time when they had to do all the work and so everybody else got the good grade. They have a horror of it for that reason. I tell them, and this is the truth, I don't care if I get one exam paper that has the class list attached as the people who produced this exam. That's fine. I don't care if your group has 15 people in it. That's fine. This is your exam paper for every name attached to this. And it's incredibly important, right? Since we're a community of inquiry, that we all acknowledge each other's contributions to this. So if you're in a group and you have gained some insight by talking to somebody who's not in the group, that person has to get footnoted as somebody who contributed to this. One of the things I've discovered, this is incredibly effective at the University of Chicago. Okay. The students who do group exams with one another work so hard on those things together. They argue out everything. They read and read and read. I set up these virtual classrooms for them and, you know, discussion boards and all kinds of things like that to help. I'll get them physical classroom space if they all want to physically meet in a classroom space. Anything I can think of to help. If somebody would really like to be part of a group and is too shy to actually ask the person they've been greeting for several weeks to be in a group with them, I will send out an email asking for the names of anyone who would like to be in a group and isn't yet in one. And then we make the group. And they meet for the first time with me in the office. And they get to know each other a little bit. And I mean, some very fast friendships have formed this way. I have never had students forget any material covered on a group exam because the process of generating that exam paper is so intensive and so powerful for them. And for University of Chicago kids, the first time they've ever had intensive intellectual engagement with their fellow students with a particular task in view, outside of, you know, a group work moment in a classroom. So this is a thing that they do. It's really powerful for them. Okay. That was what I wanted to say about lecture classes. I hope that was useful somehow, or some bit of it was. Now, I've talked a bit about what makes a trait a virtue. I've talked a bit about moral knowledge. I've talked a bit about how you can rely on that. Now I want to move to talking specifically, pretty specifically actually, about courage. But before I do that and talk at you for another big chunk of time, let's take 30 seconds or 45 seconds and just have a pause. You can talk to each other. You can text somebody. You can get on the iPad and play your game, whatever suits. But let's take a little break. Doing okay?
Yeah.
It's all right? Something useful or interesting or at least amusing or... Doing okay? Okay. Courage. You have a quote on your handout from Michael Pakaluk, who's actually really nice scholar of Aquinas. A virtue is a trait that makes someone such that his activity, with a lot of these guys, what he does, what he's responsible for is reasonable, but there's four basic types of such activity: his thinking itself as practical and directed at action, his actions, ordinarily so called, and how he is affected. The last category splits into two, Aquinas thinks, on the grounds that acting reasonably in the realm of the passions involves regulating both the passions by which we are drawn to something and the passions by which we are repulsed from something. These two sorts of passions imply two sorts of tasks or achievements, which the ordinary distinction between the virtues of temperance and courage confirms. See how the account of what a virtue is fits in with an understanding of the sets of things that are basic in human life. You need to be able to think well. You need your external actions to be well-ordered. You need your attractions and your aversions to be appropriate. That's a basic framework that I have found incredibly useful for thinking about virtue. It's pretty simple and it's pretty powerful. Now, the traditional story about how you acquire virtue, of course, goes like this. We're building the relevant strength of character by performing virtuous acts. We build justice by doing right by one another in full understanding of all that we owe to each other and to God. We build courage, both by developing an understanding of the risks that it's worth taking, the good that's at stake in our circumstances, and how best to handle fear or anxiety in the face of things that threaten those goods. We build temperance by refraining from indulging ourselves in various ways. Practical wisdom comes from a lot of experience with ourselves and the world, and so on. That's the traditional story. In the very traditional story, in the Aristotle story that Aquinas to some extent but not entirely accepts, there's only a tiny minority of noblemen who could even get virtue to begin with, this teeny minority group of candidates here. And they start by borrowing their fathers, by imitating their fathers. That's how they initially get into the business of virtue. That's not a picture of acquisition of virtue that acquisition, especially of a virtue like courage, that has immediate points of application in the classroom. Right? I mean, the traditional story of courage in Aristotle is about being aggressive in a wise way. Like you're on the battlefield, you defend the city, you're aggressive in the appropriate way. Because it's worth defending the city, because it falls to you to do it, because it's not a foolish battle, all these kinds of things. Aggression on the battlefield. The stunning conclusion of the story of the grandmother that Susan gave us last night points to the other side of courage. The side that in that case, it's Jewish courage, but I think it's the kind of courage that we associate with Christ as well. Christian courage may show itself in battle, chasing money changers from the temple, but Christians, starting with Christ, have more often been called upon to show courage in enduring hardship, suffering, humiliation, persecution, torture, and death, rather than renounce their faith. That's the kind that Jesus warns us about a lot. We find exemplars of Christian courage in Christ's sacrifice for our sakes, and in the suffering of Christian martyrs to this day. I don't know of any account of Christian courage that says that we should cultivate it by repeatedly seeking out occasions when we might be made to suffer for our faith. This is not a way to pursue Christian courage. For Aquinas, it would betray or speak to a deep failure of reverence for the life that Christ gave me to lead, like this very one, this embodied being. An absolute disrespect if I'm racing off looking to be humiliated or persecuted qua Christian. That's not Christian courage. Okay. Now, a lot of the discussion of this kind of hardship courage, assess courage, had gotten transmuted into talk about ascetic practices of one sort or another by the time Aquinas was writing. Most of the contemporaries Aquinas knew about lived in Christendom. So the other sort, persecution, martyrdom, that was less common than it had been in the early church. Most of the classrooms that are of interest to us are not, I think, in general, sites for training soldiers, even if our students go on to military careers. Christian classrooms certainly ought to really, you know, support various things, among them faith. I take it that what you're doing when you're cultivating Aristotelian-style courage nowadays has more to do with training your body in various ways and being involved in various ways in sort of social training, defensive training, things like that. On the assumption that the organization for which might send you into battle is just or good or would only be involved in something that it was good to be involved in. There has to be a good governing any of this stuff. I take it that the way you can help to cultivate Christian courage in a classroom, whether or not you're explicit about it, is by helping your students learn how to fear the right stuff for the right reason in the right way, given the goods at stake in that classroom. Students worry about all kinds of stuff, a lot about how they appear to teachers and fellow students and other people as well, a lot about grades, a lot about all kinds of things. And classrooms seem like anxious testing grounds where these things are going to be brought to a head and so on. But the good that's at stake in the classroom is actually educational experience. And fear over the loss of an opportunity to engage with a community of inquiry in educational experience is so far down on the list of the things that would scare my students if you asked them to list the things that were scary about classrooms, that like I would be shocked if it even got mentioned. So my students are not going to walk into classrooms, however safe or scary they are, fearing the right things, being anxious about the right things. And that's partly a matter of needing to build with them an understanding of the kind of good that's at stake for us. In our discussion of anxiety before supper, there was talk about the possibility of there being good anxiety and bad anxiety. There's a kind of anxiety that I think is rightly, almost a Kierkegaardian sense, that's rightly associated with an educational experience. Educational experiences are disruptive. Among my colleagues, we call this the terrible risk of the second half of your thought. Right. My colleagues and I will talk, not in the philosophy department, but around the university more generally. We'll talk about how, you know, you get the first half of your thought nailed down, you're really excited. And then the thing to do is to finish the thought. And it sometimes will happen that in the course of working out part two, part one kind of falls apart on you. And suddenly you can't take for granted the thing that made part one seem so solid. Okay? That happens with educational experiences a lot. And I'm not always there's a risk in learning, actually. It is unsettling. You might have to let go of something that you liked a lot. You might have to take on board something that has been a little unattractive. You might have to take very seriously things that people you have not respected say, think, and do. All of these things can be part of an educational experience. They're all, in fact, scary. There's, in fact, built into the good that's at stake in classrooms an element of risk. When my students want to know how to approach other faculty around the university to get help with a paper or a research project, what I usually tell them is, here's your best hope with most of them. You walk in there and you say, okay, here's the thing I feel like I know how to think about. Here's the thing I wish I knew how to think about, but I really don't know how to think about. I was hoping that this paper would help me get from there to here. Would you be willing to help me? That's a kind of approach that works really well with most of my colleagues in most departments, right? Because the student is understanding that there's an attempt in writing a paper at actually expanding the kinds of things the student can think. Now, everybody knows that usually the thing that seemed really solid initially is about to get wobbly. That's okay. There has to be a place to start. You start from there and move forward. But that kind of anxiety, it's okay to have together. And it's okay not to soothe that one, because you would be lying to your students if you tried to act like there was nothing at stake in this, in your self-understanding or in how you were with other people. I mean, if you're at a conference like this, the chances, I think, are really good that you actually think that what happens in your classes is important. And you actually think that what role you play in what happens in your classes matters, right? There's real goods at stake here. And your job, I think, is to try to help make the resources associated with those goods available to your students, empowering to your students, and so on, even though the business of getting in a position to use them might be sort of alarming, or scary, or anxiety provoking, or whatever. Now, I have all kinds of good fortune in my discipline, philosophy, which is kind of shocking. But one of the things that's really nice is that you get huge points in philosophy for specific things that you don't understand, right? Like, my students get rewarded for being like this in most classes, like boom, 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 I've got an answer, here we go. Not in philosophy class. In philosophy class, the thought is that if it's a topic we're thinking about, chances are it's too hard to solve in 2 minutes. Like, it's not going to sort itself out that quickly. I want to say a few things about discussion classes and how to use those as an opportunity to build this kind of awareness of the good at stake for us. When I get to teach discussion classes, the first day of class is always an art project. I come in with folded pieces of manila paper and many colorful implements, pens, things like that. What everybody's going to do is produce a card with their first name written on it in whatever way suits, provided that it's legible from the other side of the table or the room or something like that. Okay? And those are going to be, we're going to bring those every time. And those are going to go in front of us. I make one with a name on it. And when we start discussion, I'll usually pose a question. I'm old fashioned. But then we have to pause for 30 whole seconds before anybody responds to it, before anybody gets called on, and we all know this, which means that you've got a moment to think. I managed to shame my colleagues when I chaired my department by pointing out that failing to do something like this was, in effect, penalizing students in philosophy class for thinking before they spoke, which struck everybody as like bad practice, right? So we think before we speak. And then it starts, and then the last person to speak recognizes the next speaker. So, if you answer, you will have started the conversation with me, And then I'll probably have to say, you've got hands. And you'll turn around and look and say, oh, Susan. And then it's Susan's turn. And when Susan finishes, I'll usually have to say something like, you've got hands, because it takes them a while to learn how to even look at each other at this moment and notice when somebody wants to speak. And then Susan will call on the next person. And in all of this, I have to raise my hand too. I don't always get called on. It doesn't hurt my feelings. I will, in draconian fashion, intervene if we're getting too wild or something. But all kinds of things happen through this. A, the students are much more likely to address the last thing said. They learn how to have a conversation because they're calling on each other instead of playing ping pong with me. B, if I have a student who somehow likes to kind of dominate discussion, it's not me trying to squelch that person. The whole dynamic of the classroom encourages behaviors that support conversation and don't leave a whole lot of space for dominance. So if somebody's raising his hand every time, chances are very good that the fellow students are not going to be calling on that person every time. So you get much broader level of participation, and it takes the form of an actual conversation. They have to learn how to do that. That's not the norm. But they love it once they've learned how to do that. And yeah, everybody knows everybody's name. Everybody's used to trying to sort stuff out with everybody else. We all are in the mood that we don't ever have to manufacture seriousness for anything that we do up out of like furrowed brows and clenched fists, things like that. Because the material and the setting are serious and they hold that for us. The fact that we're all engaged with this topic in the middle of us holds the seriousness. So we can have loose moments and laugh. We can tell jokes. We can do those things. We don't have to worry because the material and the fact that we're in a community working with that material holds the seriousness of what we're up to for us. We don't have to invent it. What we're trying to do there, in my mind, is actually work against what I take to be false forms of fear. Being afraid of the wrong thing in this setting, being afraid in the wrong way, not understanding the character of the good that's at stake for us as a community, that sort of stuff. So that we are all alert to the genuine good that we're trying to pursue collectively in the class, which means that we're all in a position to be afraid of the right thing, namely something that damages that, and so could disrupt the thing that we're trying to do as a community. That is a way, teaching people what to fear by teaching them what's worth risking something for. What's not, teaching them, that is part of cultivating courage. Okay. Indirect, they're not having to do anything too brave, right? But they are having to jointly take responsibility for a conversation, the class, all those things. And then we know the thing that's at stake, and we know the thing we have to protect, and we know the thing that it would be terrible to damage or to lose. And that's a kind of cultivation of courage that can happen in the classroom. Okay. The final thing I wanted to say, and I'm sorry I've talked at you so long, had to do with a place where I think Christians especially need to stand up these days. And it does have to do with moral prohibition. I'm in an entirely different part of my academic life. I'm working on an argument that human beings as such, qua human beings, expect that good will come of good and that all bets are off about what will happen next if they knowingly do things that they really shouldn't be doing. Now, there's lots of ways acts can be bad. They can be bad in their circumstance. They can be bad in this way. They can be bad that way. They can also, as I've mentioned before, be bad in their kind. Okay. The world is really fond of presenting us with situations recently where it looks like we're told that if we won't support doing acts of one of these kinds in some situation, recently I guess probably torture has been the big one, right? If we can't find a situation if it looks like the only way to get this information out and there's a ticking bomb and this other stuff, right? It's an emergency, we should torture the guy. Right? That's become kind of a topic in U.S. popular culture and understanding of late. And one of the things I work on myself and with my students, without being able to talk to my students about what I take to be the real ground of this, is the need to refuse to go along with that kind of a story. The need to refuse to think that you can do a thing that you know to be bad, expecting good to come of it, calculating on good. Now, it's my great hope that certainly Christians, but I would hope theists more generally, would be willing to hold with support of moral prohibition under situations where you're given these kinds of arguments. But I think that the world doesn't really understand what's going on when Christians will stand up for this sort of thing. I think the world has a strong tendency to try to understand what people do by thinking a lot about calculation. So the world will think, one of the things the world might think, is that we're siding with faith because we're afraid that we'll go to hell if we don't. Of course, if we believe in hell, then we also think that it is a circumstance that ought to be avoided. It's not a place we would want to wind up eternally damned, right? So it's not that someone who fears eternal damnation has like the wrong idea about eternal damnation. It's perfectly reasonable. But this sort of calculation is at odds with both the rational basis of a Christian orientation to the future and the support that we have from grace, I think. The rational basis has it that any good that comes of sin is an accident. We get no credit for some good thing that happens to happen when we sin. That's not part of what's in the sin. Okay? The wages of sin is death, not a better world. Okay? The basis of grace is deeply rooted in both faith and love. Our job is to try to walk with Christ as best we can. The idea that we might follow Christ's example because we're afraid that we'll suffer if we don't misconstrues Christianity at its root. This way of reckoning our courage is to that extent just wrong. The second way the world tries to account for Christian courage is by attributing to us a special sort of magical thinking. It's not that cost-benefit calculation is the wrong way to understand Christian courage. It's that Christians think that God is like the great cost-benefit guy in the sky. God is just going to alter the payoff structure in such a way that in the long run, and you know the long run could stretch to eternity, very long, just as a matter of fact, no good is going to come of a bad deed. Okay. Again, it's not that it's wrong to think that God holds creation in his hands, but trying to account for God's care for creation on the model of some sort of morally loaded, magically balanced cost-benefit system misses the whole force of Christian courage by locating its appeal in the wrong sort of orientation to the future, this kind of calculative, merely predictive sort. Again, this way of trying to understand Christian courage flies in the face of both reason and faith. Reason teaches us that good is supposed to come of good and that sin is not a wellspring of good. Sin is evil in action, and as such, it's to be avoided, even when the world expects good to come from sin and great evil to come from courageous refusal to sin. Faith teaches us that our efforts to walk with Christ are efforts to be good human beings, efforts to live in such a way that our powers and passions are appropriately governed, and we come as close as we can to rectifying our wills, right? To do such in order, in part, to be right with God. None of us can get to God under our own steam. Salvation is a matter of grace, not works, of course, right? But as Christians, we're called upon to do stuff too. And I think that as such, Christian moral courage exemplifies the way that Christians refuse to be drawn into this kind of cost-benefit calculation in deciding what to do. Its faith teaches us to know better than that. And that's what I have for you. Thank you very much. We've got time if you want to use it to talk to me about anything and all of that, or to talk to one another. Put out a general question. Oh. Silence. Yes. Let me come down so I can actually hear you, or go to a microphone so everybody can.
It's just kind of a practical one. When you were discussing, when you were demonstrating this discussion format, students together and so on, do you, having done this with smaller children or younger adults, do you at some point find that you do have to keep the discussion going? I mean, what's your involvement in that over? And how long might you do that? It's very practical.
Yeah, no, we do, this thing is called floating chair. And we do it the whole discussion section, basically, which is usually 50 minutes for a discussion section in the canonical schedule at my school. I will intervene periodically. Usually because it looks like what somebody said went missing, right? So if a student spoke softly and tentatively or something, or said something that was a little off to the side, I might redirect us to that comment if that comment gets sort of swallowed up in the buzz that's going on in the room. Only once, I think, in doing this for 15 years, ever actually gone in to forcibly take a strand of discussion away. Okay, and it was partly because we had a young fellow in a class who was a big Nietzsche enthusiast, a really big Nietzsche enthusiast, in this instance, because he believed that Nietzsche really had done the philosophy necessary to support National Socialism. Right, and so he really wanted to get this whole idea out on the table. It's not that I refused to let him speak. It's that it was, we don't have trigger warnings, but like this would have been a trigger warning for me, right? It was sort of scary. But what I did was say, it's very hard for me to see how this fits with the things that so-and-so and so-and-so were raising for us. I'm just not quite getting the connection here. Could you explain the connection to me? Right. And he was insulted and stormed out of the room. And so solved the problem for me. But that's the only time that I can recall. But it was partly because of what was being thrown out in the middle of the room, which was really kind of alarming. Yeah.
You'd mentioned earlier about some of your students identifying you as a friendly. At a Christian university, we don't have to deal with that. Most of us probably are. But I'm curious how that dance goes for you.
Well, actually, people with faith generally will recognize me as a friendly. So I get Muslim students, I get students who are, the most stunning ones was a young woman whose family had just emigrated from Africa, and it was traditional African cultural practices that were connected to both cultural identity and spiritual stuff for her that she wanted to talk about with somebody from the university. I mean, I think at those moments, what I am is just a face that says University of Chicago attached to it, who can be there as a sounding board for people. The Christians just spot me. You know, it's like homosexual people used to talk about gaydar and stuff. It's like the Christians somehow just spot me. And so they will come up, and sometimes they will come up because they want to talk about how difficult it is to be called upon to defend their faith all the time, as they are at my university. And sometimes they'll be thinking about transferring, I mean, especially Catholic students will be thinking about transferring to Notre Dame or something, to be someplace where everybody is in their faith tradition. But what often happens is that the business of defending their faith all the time with their peers actually strengthens and deepens their faith, so that the kind of wellspring of faith that they're working with is in better shape than what they're going to find down the road in South Bend. And that's often been their experience, that, you know, but they need somebody to say, I'm having to make this argument all the time. Moral prohibition has been another one lately, where I've had three separate occasions, I've had Christian students come to find me because they've just been very disturbed that their fellow students at the University of Chicago seem to think that it would be okay to murder people, or it would be okay to bomb a city, or it would be okay to rape people or something like this under sufficiently whacked out emergency circumstances if you thought it was the only way to prevent some terrible, terrible, terrible thing from happening. Right, and philosophers are really good at inventing those cases. It's like, it's easy. Take whatever terrible thing is being threatened and just that you're being asked to do, and just multiply it n times and say, they're gonna do that over here 150 times if you don't do it once right here. And so they'll ask me, they'll be very demoralized by this because it looks like their fellow students don't have any respect for this basic part of moral life. And I will talk to them about having an unfair advantage. That the fact that we've got this kind of faith in some ways relieves us of a particular kind of a burden. In particular, the burden of thinking that we could ever do act of that kind and expect it to be good. Like, that much faith can support us whether or not we can articulate the basis of that in a way that's gonna be influential with fellow students who don't have any kind of faith at all. Right. I mean, so there. This week, my very first office hour, our class has just started on Monday, this term did. I'm only half time this year because I'm starting this big grant, but so I'm not teaching this term, but I'm the, but this young woman who has just started the Master's of Arts program in the humanities, for which I am the philosophy department liaison, meaning the human being from the philosophy department who's available to them, came up to my new office. And she was kind of really hesitant and really, you know, and I could tell that she's just kind of being overwhelmed by like the gargoyles and the stone buildings and the whole University of Chicago-ness of the University of Chicago. So I talked about my first week in the job where I kept thinking they must have made a mistake, partly because of this like neo-Gothic Dickens world or something that is the campus. But it turns out she went to Southeast Baptist College and now finds herself at the University of Chicago, and it is major culture shock, and it is major tremulous moment for her with her faith. And that's what she really wanted to be able to talk about, and she had not ever met me before, so she had no idea that she was talking to somebody who would be friendly to that. So getting to talk to her and draw her out a little bit about how this place can be alarming and how this place can feel like it challenges faith, and how in my experience after 22 years, actually this is not a bad place to be rooted there at all, even though the institution as a whole isn't providing support for that aspect of your being. It can still be at the center of your engagement in your intellectual life here, even if it's not the thing that's thematized in your classes, even if you can't start with the piece, the way Allison started, talked about starting for us this afternoon, or this morning. But that's that. Okay.